Turn in your Bibles with me to Isaiah chapter 13. We are hopefully going to look at, we're going to go very quickly through Isaiah 13 and 14 today, this morning, but I'm going to begin our time just by reading the first five verses from this God's holy word. The oracle concerning Babylon, which Isaiah the son of Amoz saw. On a bare hill, raise a signal, cry aloud to them, wave the hand for them to enter the gates of the nobles. I myself have commanded my consecrated ones and have summoned my mighty men to execute my anger, my proudly exulting ones. The sound of a tumult is on the mountains, as of a great multitude, the sound of an uproar of kingdoms, of nations gathering together. The Lord of hosts is mustering a host for battle. They come from a distant land, from the ends of the heavens, the Lord and the weapons of his indignation to destroy the whole land. Father, open up this your word to our hearts that we would see it clearly. May your spirit speak through it. In Jesus' name, amen. This begins a section in Isaiah chapter 13, really on to chapter 24 and even into chapter 27, is a section about the judgment that God's going to bring to the nations. There's a whole list of nations here that are listed. And it begins with the judgment that is going to come upon Babylon. Now, immediately, this causes all kinds of problems for critical scholars, people who don't trust the authority of the Bible and think that somehow the way the Bible is ordered or arranged, the biblical books are not very logical or they're out of sequence or whatever. The reason is because Isaiah, if we put everything in context, is writing this maybe 704, maybe 705 BC. And Babylon is around, but Babylon is not a world power. It is not a dominating world power at this particular time. In fact, it won't be a dominating world power for a period of time yet. And Israel, the nation of Israel, won't be threatened by Babylon for a good while. Eventually it will. And Babylon won't come to its end for another 200 years. So it would sort of be like me saying, making a prediction about Canada and how Canada is going to be, you know, this evil empire of Canada is going to be swallowed up in 200 years later. And people are like, well, who cares about Canada? They're not threatening us at all. Why does Babylon show up at this particular point in Isaiah's book? And I think the answer is actually fairly simple. From the beginning of the Bible, Babylon has been symbolic. It has been the symbolic nation that represents all evil, proud, arrogant, self-serving, violent, conquering nations. From the very beginning, when the people in Genesis chapter 11 built a city near this region, and they called it the tower. It was called the Tower of Babel. And they built a tower up to heavens. It was called the Tower of Babel. Ever since Genesis 11, Babylon or the Tower of Babel have been symbolic of the arrogant pride of nations. And this will follow through all the way to the end of the Bible. Even in Revelation, you hear a lot about Babylon. Babylon doesn't even exist by the time we get to Revelation. But the world power at the time is Rome. And so Babylon is a code word in the book of Revelation for Rome, for the dominant world power. So when you see Babylon in the Bible, sometimes it refers to the actual nation. And this will refer to the actual nation, but understand that the implications are far broader. It refers to any powerful nation that rules in pride and in arrogance, whether it's Assyria, whether it's Babylon, whether it's Greece, whether it's Rome, whether it's the Medo-Persian Empire, whatever empire it is, Babylon often will represent that. And the point of it is, so that's one of the reasons, is Babylon is symbolically represents the other nations. But the other reason, of course, is that in a number of years, Babylon will be the greatest threat to the nation of Israel. Won't be the greatest threat to the northern tribes. They will be gone. They'll be wiped out by the Assyrians. But the southern nation of Israel and the city of Jerusalem will eventually be surrounded by Babylon, and eventually Jerusalem will be captured by Babylon, and the city walls will be torn down by Babylon, and the temple will be destroyed by Babylon, and the people will be carried away into captivity and live in Babylon. So Isaiah is looking deep into the future and saying what God will eventually do to this powerful nation, the nation of Babylon. And here's what happens in the first five verses is that he rouses an army. He raises a signal. Remember, he puts up a banner. He puts up a flag. That's what the signal is in verse 2. And he raises an army. This is the poetic picture of an army being gathered together to accomplish the Lord's purpose. They come from distant lands in verse 5, this army that is gathered. The Lord and the weapons of his indignation to destroy the whole land. These soldiers are even called, interestingly enough, they're called his holy ones in, what verse is that? Or to enter, I myself commanded my consecrated ones, verse 3. I myself have commanded my consecrated ones, it is in ESV, literally it says holy ones. And it's not saying holy or consecrated in the sense of moral perfection, but in the sense of these are people that are going to do my bidding. These soldiers that I've mustered together are going to do my bidding, and what they're going to do is they're going to attack Babylon. So what we're going to have throughout 13 and into 14 is a picture of this army and a picture of what happens when this mighty and great nation, the nation of Babylon, falls by the hand of God. So let's keep reading. It begins in verse 6, wail, for the day of the Lord is near as destruction from the Almighty. It will come. Therefore, all hands will be feeble and every human heart will melt. They will be dismayed, pangs and agony will seize them. They will be in anguish like a woman in labor. They will look aghast at one another. Their faces will be aflame. This is a picture of, you know, the army's coming, and you know it's coming, and you can't avoid it. And what do? You shake in terror. Your face melts. I mean, your face goes white because of fear, and that's what's being called for here. Why? Because this massive army is coming to conquer you. It's coming to conquer Babylon. Behold, in verse 9, the day of the Lord comes cruel with wrath and fierce anger to make the land desolate, to make the land a desolation, and to destroy its sinners from it. God's judgment is oftentimes called in the Old Testament the day of the Lord. It's the day of God's wrath. It's judgment day. It's the day when God will bring his power and his fury, and he will, as it says, destroy its sinners, make its land desolate to destroy its sinners from it. In other words, he's going to purify the land by removing the sinful corruption that is in it. In verse 10, for the stars of the heavens and their constellations will not give their light. The sun will be dark at its rising and the moon will not shed its light. I will punish the world for its evil and the wicked for their iniquity. I will put an end to the pomp of the arrogant and lay low the pompous pride of the ruthless. Now, one word there about verse 10, where the stars of the heavens and the constellations will not give their light, the sun will be dark. That is poetic language. It's very typical of the Old Testament. It's typical of Ezekiel, Jeremiah, it's typical of Isaiah and other prophets. And that is poetic language of saying God's going to shake the world in such a dramatic way. It's going to be just as dramatic as if the sun ceased to shine, as if the stars were moved around and disoriented. It doesn't literally mean that the sun's going to stop shining or that the moon's going to stop giving its light. It simply means that God's working in the world is going to cause such a dramatic shift in the political arena, in the military arena, in other ways, that it's going to be as if the heavens itself were shaken. That's poetic language. Jesus, by the way, as a side note, Jesus uses this language in the Sermon, or not in the Sermon on the Mount, on the Olivet Discourse. In Matthew chapter 24, remember, he says, immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. That's Jesus using poetic language. It's Jesus being a prophet. He's not necessarily predicting that there's going to be a time of great darkness. He's simply saying that the world is going to be shaken by these events in such a way it will be as if the heavens themselves have ceased to give their light. All right, in verse 11 then, God is punishing the evil, the wicked, and particularly the pomp of the arrogance and the pompous pride of the ruthless. This is always the thing that God goes after in judgment. He goes after the pride and the arrogance of the wicked. And this is particularly true of mighty nations, and it's particularly true of powerful rulers and powerful kings. They're proud and they're arrogant, and God will, on the day of the Lord, put them in their place. Verse 12, I will make the people more rare than fine gold, and mankind than the gold of Ophir. In other words, it'll be easier to find gold than it will be to find people. That's how devastating this day of the Lord will be. 13, therefore, I will make the heavens tremble, and the earth will be shaken out of its place at the wrath of the Lord of hosts in the day of his fierce anger. You get this idea that this is a big earth-shattering event that's going to happen here. And like a hunted gazelle and like sheep with none to gather them, each will turn to his own people and each will flee to his own land. You know, it's I remember during 9/11, I was in Philadelphia when the towers came down. And I was there for most of the day and drove home later in the day after they shut the seminary down. That's where I was. And the eeriest feeling was driving from Philadelphia home down the road, because when you drove home, there were hardly any cars on the highway. There were no cars in the parking lots. There were no cars in the shopping malls. There were no cars in the business places. Why? Because everybody went home. Everybody fled home when they found out what was happening. And indeed, they were told to do so. And this is what happens when the enemy invades. Where do people do? Well, they flee to the safest place they know. They try to run away, but they'll flee home if their home isn't where the enemy's coming. And so that's what's the picture of here. Just as these animals, sheep and gazelle, they're good at running. they're good at running away from trouble. That's what's going to happen to the people. And then in verse 15 and 16, you get a sense of how terrible and graphic and evil this conquering will be. Whoever is found will be thrust through, and whoever is caught will fall by the sword. Their infants will be dashed in pieces before their eyes. Their houses will be plundered and their wives ravished. Now, this is horrific language, but this is exactly the way the Babylonians treated other nations they conquered. So what's going to happen to them by the hand of the Lord is the same thing that they, is in a sense, the same way they treated other people. With such violence. And then verse 17, behold, I am stirring up the Medes against them, who have no regard for silver and do not delight in gold. Cyrus the Mede was the king that actually eventually conquered Babylon. And this was true of him, evidently. He wasn't all that impressed with gold and silver. You couldn't bribe him. You couldn't say, hey, I'll give you this truckload of gold if you don't invade us. And Cyrus said, I don't care about gold. I care about power and I care about conquering things. And so this evidently is very much descriptive of what would happen eventually. Verse 18, the battle continues. Their bows will slaughter the young men. They will have no mercy on the fruit of the womb, and their eyes will not pity children. Again, a picture of the violence. And then in verses 19 to the end, you basically have the complete destruction of Babylon. In Babylon, the glory of kingdoms, the splendor and pomp of the Chaldeans will be like Sodom and Gomorrah when God overthrew them. It will never be inhabited or lived in for all generations. No Arab will pitch his tent there. No shepherd will make their flocks lie down there. But wild animals will lie down there, and their houses will be full of howling creatures. There ostriches will dwell, and there wild goats will dance. Hyenas will cry in its towers, and jackals in the pleasant places. Its time is close at hand, and its days will not be prolonged. You can go to ancient Babylon right today. You know that? You can go there. You know what it is? It's a tourist attraction because of the ruins. In 1987, actually, Saddam Hussein tried to rebuild the city. He spent a lot of effort and a lot of money and began to rebuild things, but it wasn't all that successful. Babylon, once the greatest city, it was one of the great wonders of the ancient world, the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. The city was just a marvel of technology. It was a marvel of beauty. It was a picture of man's great accomplishments. And now it's nothing but a pile of ruins, just as God's word predicted it would be. At the time, you could not have imagined Babylon being a pile of ruins. At the height, you could say this city is going to go on for thousands of years. And as it turned out, not only did the city not survive, the nation itself, the powerful nation of Babylon, was brought to nothing by the hand of God. Eventually, Babylon was conquered in 539 by the Medes and the Persians. You read a little bit about that in Daniel when you remember the story of the writing on the wall with Belshazzar. Belshazzar was the last king of Babylon, and Belshazzar that night saw Babylon fall to the Medes and to King Cyrus. Now, verse 14 continues this description of Babylon, but the first three verses or two verses here are very, very important. Because you want to ask, because here's the question we need to ask ourselves is, why does God destroy Babylon? What is it that he has against this people? Yeah, they're proud, and yeah, they're arrogant, and yeah, they're sinful. So is God just destroying them because of their arrogance and their pride and their sin? And there's another reason God is bringing Babylon to dust. And it tells us in verse 1 of chapter 14, "For the Lord will have compassion on Jacob, and will again choose Israel, and will set them in their own land, and sojourners will join them, and will attach themselves to the house of Jacob." Notice the conjunction there, notice the preposition, the "for." It's the very first word in English. For the Lord will have compassion on it. Why? Babylon is going to be destroyed. Why? Because the Lord is going to have compassion on his children. The very nation that would one day surround the city of Jerusalem, destroy it, destroy the temple, and carry the inhabitants away into captivity, that very nation is going to be destroyed. Why? So God can send his people back to their land. God's judgment is never the last word. I said this last week. God's judgment is never the last word. God doesn't judge people for the sake of judging them, and that's that. And he's, God's judgment is only the first step in preparing for the next step. And the next step is for God to return his people to their land and reestablish them, and for them to be a nation now that praises God and worships God and obeys God. Instead of them being sojourners in a land that was not their own, now they're going to return to their land, and now sojourners are going to come through their land. In fact, there's going to be a great reversal. Israel, the nation of Israel, and the people of Israel, who were once slaves and once had other people telling them what to do, are now going to be the ones who are going to be in control, and they're the ones who are going to dominate the world. Look at verse 2. "And the peoples will take them and bring them to their place, and the house of Israel will possess them in the Lord's land." These are the sojourners come to the Lord's land. "The Lord's people will possess them as male and female slaves, and they will take captives those who were their captors and rule over those who oppressed them." Now, a lot of people get upset with that language of verse 2 because it talks about slavery. But understand, in this particular day and age, you were one of two things. You were either the ruler, or you were ruled by somebody else. And so all verse 2 is saying is Israel has been the ruled over. They have been the slaves for so long that God, in his power and in his love for Israel, is now going to reverse that to the point where now Israel is the nation that rules. And God's people are the ones who are in control. It's the great reversal. In other words, God's judgment on Babylon, yes, is because of their pride and sin, but it's also because God has a purpose for his people. And because God wants to ultimately bring glory to his name, and that's what he's going to do through his people. Now, verse 3 says, when the Lord has given you rest from your pain and turmoil, and the hard service with which you were made to serve, you will take up this taunt against the king of Babylon. Now, there's another poem, verse 4, the end of verse 4, all the way to verse 21. Is a poem that taunts the king of Babylon. And in Hebrew, the people who study Hebrew say this is one of the finest examples of Hebrew poetry that we have in our possession. Now, it loses some of that symmetry and some of that rhythm in English, but in Hebrew, it's the perfect picture of Hebrew poetry. And it's right here in the middle of Isaiah chapter 14. It's a poem in four stanzas. The first stanza is going to give the perspective of the earth. Now that the king of Babylon has been conquered and killed, because ultimately this taunt is about a dead king. This is the perspective of the earth from verses 4 to 8. How the oppressor has ceased, the insolent fury ceased. The Lord has broken the staff of the wicked and the scepter of rulers that struck the peoples in wrath with unceasing blows, that ruled the nations in anger with unrelenting persecution. That's a description of this king's rule. The whole earth is at rest and quiet. They break forth into singing. The cypress rejoice at you, the cedars of Lebanon saying, since you were laid low, no woodcutter comes up against us. This is the land itself is singing because the king of Babylon is dead. Why? Because now the land is at rest. Now the world is at peace. Even the forest cries in gratitude because now there's no woodcutters to come and chop down the trees and make instruments of war and make fine, fancy, expensive houses, you know, for the king of Babylon. Now everything is at rest and at peace. So even the world, the earth itself rejoices in the death of this mighty, proud, arrogant king. The second stanza then will talk about how will give us the perspective of this king's death from Sheol. Sheol is the Hebrew word for, sometimes it's translated as hell. It simply means the place of the dead. And so Sheol gives us the perspective of this king who is now descending into the place of the dead. Verse 9, Sheol beneath is stirred up to meet you when you come. It rouses the shades to greet you. All who were leaders of the earth, it raises from their thrones all who were kings of the nations. All of them will answer and say to you, you too have become as weak as we are. You have become like us. So this is a picture of the dead in Sheol, the dead kings who have died thousands of years. You know, all the great mighty men, they all get together and say, aha, here comes the mighty king of Babylon to be just like we are. He comes to the place of the dead. You've become as weak as we are. You have become like us, it says in verse 10. Your pomp is brought down to Sheol, the sound of your harps. There's a pomp, there's a sound of harps. Is that what we have? No. Look at the end of verse 11. Maggots are laid as a bed beneath you, and worms are your covers. Death is the great equalizer. You know, it doesn't matter how famous you are, how rich you are, how important you are. Everybody might pay attention to you every single day, but you know what? When you die, you're just like everybody else. Death is the great equalizer, the mighty king of Babylon. And so the perspective of death, the people in Sheol, they're like, well, here he comes, the great king of Babylon. He is no more. He's just like us. Now, the third stanza is going to be the perspective of heaven. Verse 12, how you are fallen from heaven, O day star, son of dawn. How you are cut down to the ground, you who laid the nations low. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven above the stars. I will set my throne on high. I will sit on the mount of assembly in the far reaches of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. But you are brought down to Sheol, to the far reaches of the pit. Here's a king who is so full of himself, he thinks he's going to put his throne in the heavens. He thinks he's so much greater than all other kings, all other people, and yet what happens to him? God brings him not only down from the lofty heavens in his mind, but he brings him down to the very pit of hell itself. That's the hand of God, and that's what God does to human pride. Now, I should note here, you might have caught this, some ancient theologians think this is oftentimes, they think this is a reference to Satan himself, who was cast down out of heaven. But the more modern scholars, and typically since the Reformation, the understanding here is this is not so much about Satan as it is about a human king or about the proud and arrogant. This is ultimately a picture of a man who is on earth thinking that he is more important than he is, and God eventually bringing him down low to the grave itself. That's stanza three. Stanza four then goes back to the earth. One final disgrace of this king, this taunt to the king, and we're going to see that this taunt will be that this king will have no decent burial, and this king will have no descendants to come after him. Verse 16, those who see you will stare at you and ponder over you. Now, this is a picture of, imagine a dead king laying on the ground, and those who see you pondering over you. That's what's going on here. Is this the man who made the earth tremble, who shook kingdoms, who made the world like a desert and overthrew its cities, who did not let its prisoners go home? All the kings of the nations lie in glory, each in his own tomb. But you are cast out away from your grave like a loathed branch, clothed with slain, those pierced by the sword, who go down to the stones of the pit like a dead body trampled underfoot. In other words, he's not given a proper burial. He's not given a kingly burial, which it says in verse 20. You will not be joined with them in burial because you have destroyed your land. You have slain your people. Interesting that the king's sins were the fundamental sin was not that he destroyed other people. The fundamental sins is that he turned his back on his own people. He destroyed them. He wasn't even faithful to his own people. In verse 21 then, may the offspring of the evildoers nevermore be named. Prepare slaughter for his sons because of the guilt of their fathers, lest they rise and possess the land and fill the face of the earth with cities. So the ultimate indignation is, here is a pompous, here is an arrogant, here is a powerful king, and at the end of his life, he doesn't even get buried in a king's grave. And his descendants are wiped out, so his name is no longer even remembered amongst his descendants, amongst the land. The ultimate insult to a mighty and proud and arrogant person who tried to think of himself as being even more important than God. God brings him and his nation mightily low. And then in verse 23 basically summarizes all of this. I will rise up against them, declares the Lord of hosts, and will cut off from Babylon name and remnant, descendants and posterity, declares the Lord. And I will make it a possession of the hedgehog and pools of water, and I will sweep it with the broom of destruction, declares the Lord of hosts. If you were to go to Babylon during its height of power and influence, and you were to say that this is going to happen to this city, and it's going to happen to this nation, and it's going to happen to our world, they would call you crazy. But that's exactly what happened. And Isaiah predicted it even before Babylon became the great world power. Now, one other thing, and then we'll make an application here. The next four verses are not about Babylon. They're about Assyria. Assyria was the real threat during Isaiah's day. Babylon wasn't the real threat for a while, but Assyria was. And yet, this is what God says about Assyria. The Lord of hosts has sworn, as I have planned, so shall it be, and as I have purposed, so shall it stand, that I will break the Assyrian in my land, and on my mountains trample him underfoot, and his yoke shall depart from them, and his burden from their shoulder. This is the purpose that is purposed concerning the whole earth, and this is the hand that is stretched out over all the nations, for the Lord of hosts has purposed, and who will annul it? His hand is stretched out, and who will turn it back? In other words, here's what's being said. I'm going to do to Assyria exactly what I said I was going to do to Babylon. I'm going to do it to Assyria too. In fact, I'm going to do it to all of these nations in their pride, in their arrogance. who ignore me, who turn their back on me, who oppress my people, who oppress their people, I'm going to bring judgment on them. Now, what is the purpose of all of this? Every year, we sing a Christmas Advent hymn, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, who mourns in lowly exile here. See, they're in exile. They're not in their own land until the Son of God appears. Israel, as a nation, sang that song. They didn't sing that exact one, but they sang songs like that for 700 years. For 700 years, they cried out, O come, Emmanuel. God had promised Emmanuel in Isaiah chapter 9. For unto us a child is born, a son is given, the government shall be on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. The sign of Emmanuel God had promised in Isaiah 9, but the sign didn't come in a couple of years. It didn't even come in 100 years. It didn't even come in 500 years. It took 700 years from the time of Isaiah to the time of the coming of Emmanuel. And for 700 years, people prayed that God would send Emmanuel. Now, I get tired of praying for something for 7 days. Sometimes at the end of 7 months, I stop. 7 years would be a whole nother story. Can you imagine praying for something for 700 years? Why and how could people pray for something for 700 years for Emmanuel to come? They could pray for it because they knew something. They knew that God was more powerful than their worst enemies. Their worst enemy is typified by Babylon. Babylon was as bad as it got in terms of oppression, in terms of conquering, in terms of violence. And yet God was going to crush Babylon as easy as you and I crush a bug. So God, if he is more powerful than Babylon, then he's more powerful than Assyria, then he's certainly more powerful than the Persians, and he's certainly more powerful than the Greeks, and he's certainly more powerful than Rome. And so if God is more powerful than all of these nations, we can continue to pray that God would keep his word and God would send Emmanuel. See, you and I read Isaiah 13 and 14, and we just brush over it. But you realize that if chapters like this were not in the Bible, people would not have prayed for 700 years that God would keep his promise. They would be afraid. They would say, oh, God can't possibly keep his promise. This powerful nation is going to overwhelm us. Or this powerful leader is going to persecute us and rule us and going to wipe us out. Or this person is going to have. But no, but the promise was that God is more powerful than your worst enemy. And so after 700 years, Emmanuel comes, and they call his name Jesus. You will call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from the Babylonians, from the Persians, from the Greeks, from the Romans. You will call his name Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. The worst enemy you and I face is not Babylon. It's not Rome. It's not a corrupt nation. It's not corrupt leaders. The worst enemy you and I face is the effect of our own sinful pride, proud, arrogant hearts. And Jesus came to save us from that. The God who destroyed Babylon like that is the same God who comes into the world and can take away your sin like that. That's the message of Isaiah. Let's pray. Father, thank you for sending your Son into this world. How we long for that same Jesus in all of his fullness, in all of his power to come into our hearts. We long for him to overwhelm our world. We long for you to draw more people to yourself. And as we anticipate the coming of the Messiah this Christmas, as we celebrate his coming, which has already come, Lord, may you work in us that which is pleasing and perfect in your sight, and bring about this great glory that you have promised. In Jesus' name, amen.